I'm on the ride of a lifetime. I'm on a ship that's sailing to uncharted shore, and I won't be coming back here anymore. I'm on a wave, I'm on a mountain, I'm on a roller coaster sailing across the sky. And the only trouble is in wondering why.
Live from Salt Lake City, Utah, this is Heart of the Matter, where we do all we can to try to worship God in spirit and in truth. We welcome you tonight. I'm Sean McCraney, your host. We're going to cover the fourth point of TULIP tonight with our special guest, Brother Matt Slick. I want to make a few announcements to begin with. First, we've added some interesting little novelties to our website store, if you're interested. Bumper stickers or laptop stickers or refrigerator stickers. The first one is Hate the Doctrine, Love the Indoctrinated, Campus Church.tv. The next one is Absolutely Free to Love Absolutely, campuschurch.tv. And the third is campuschurch.tv, Never Leave Your Couch. And these three, one of these three will come to you free with any purchase of any products on the HOTM store. But we also have five, I think, that are novelty items that we're selling for $2.50. We enjoy their message, or at least I do. This one is All Church History Stink. That's Campus Church. This one is Campus Church, Where Everyone is Entitled to an Opinion. And they keep getting better. This one is Jesus Returned in 70 AD, Get Over It. I love it. This one is How Come Amputees Are Never Healed by Television Faith Healers. And then the final one, my favorite, is Finally a Church Full of Psychos, Drunkards, Adulterers, and Whores. And that's just the staff. Boom, boom. So if you're interested in any of those bumper sticker, laptop stickers, please go to www.hotm.tv and you can check those out. Just a way for us to keep on top of your merchandising needs. Before we hit the fourth point on Calvinism tonight with Brother Slick of CARM, that stands for Christian Apologetics Research Ministry, can be seen at www.carm.org. Great site. I use it quite a bit, to tell you the truth. A lot of great information there. I want to say a few things. First, thanks to everybody who's written in and offered your insights and commentaries. Love to get to some of those tonight if possible. I don't know if we can, if not in the weeks to come. But many of you have articulated some amazing ideas, shown great love for Matt and myself in the process. Some of you have disagreed with me. Some of you have disagreed with Matt, and yet you've done so with decorum and love. And I have learned from you. I've learned from your thoughts as I've read these emails. They're valuable to me. They have as much merit as the insights of scholars, simply because they come by the Spirit. And that's the only way we can really know the truth. Also, I want to let you know that Matt and I are working hard to be civil and strive to be civil with one another as we discuss these things. We're both strong personalities, and yet Matt loves the Lord and I love the Lord, and so we're just trying to talk about these things. I want to also point out that Matt does not make a big deal over Calvinism. He is a Christian first and foremost, and I believe this about him. He relates and he speaks to many Christians. He's obviously skilled when it comes to his approach. And so that's important to know, that he's not a Calvinist coming to preach Calvinism. He's a Christian that is coming to talk about Calvinism. And so I don't want to pigeonhole him as the Calvinist. I say that in part because the Calvinism that Matt represents, and I say this with all respect, does not represent what a lot of Calvinists think Calvinism represents. This is where it gets difficult. It gets tricky. In fact, there are some Calvinists who would think that Matt is a liberal or maybe even heretical in some of his Calvinistic views, for instance, regarding free will or things like that, or different positions. I'm sure there are some Calvinists out there who would disagree with him. This is the overall purpose and point of having Matt on the show, and I hope this is coming through, to show that good, faithful believers in Jesus Christ as the author and finisher of our faith will differ. In my opinion, we will differ on almost everything. And I mean everything. And in the end, we might individually believe that the faith has to be embraced objectively and that this is what it means and this is how it goes and you better. And I would suggest that the faith is entirely subjective, entirely known by the Spirit. And so it's really the fight I'm fighting for, if that's possible, the fight for a subjective position. But Christianity is entirely subjective, and objectivists who say you have to believe this way, I think they can stand on very, very few things. So in the end, this is the difference between me and any denominationalist, any legalist, any Calvinist, any Arminianist, any Trinitarian, any Binitarian, any futurist, any preterist, any licentious liver of the gospel. It's a difference between probably between Matt and myself. Is that, but Matt is pretty open in terms of these things. So I just want to make sure that we understand that the reason I want Matt to be on the show is to show that we have a good brother who knows his scripture and interprets them a certain way. And hopefully you'll see me as a good brother who interprets them a lot differently. And yet in the end, can we get along? Sometimes it seems like it's the difference between the scribes and Jesus. It's all about interpretation. All about interpretation. And to me, it seems like the New Testament is starting to become the law, and it's starting to become do it my way or the highway. Not starting to, it's always been that way. And so the division, I'm hoping, can end. In my book, it's absolutely okay with God that Matt and I differ, that you and I differ, that you differ with Matt. But he's my brother in Christ, and the question is, when will it be okay for all brothers and sisters in the faith to accept that we see things differently and that we're going to approach our subjective walk in the way that we believe we are led according to what we know and let other people have the same privilege? With that, let's open with a word of prayer. We're starting tonight with a recording on me about irresistible grace, the fourth point, goes about 14 or 15 minutes. Then Matt will follow up with his pre-recorded talk on irresistible grace, and then we'll come back, open up the phone lines, take your calls and comments. We already have one here on the screen we'll try to get to. Matt will be joining us at about 8:30. Let's pray. Lord, we seek you, need you, and pray that you will bless those who come seeking truth, and you'll help us to understand you in greater ways through what Matt has to say, what I have to say, and that we'll be able to discard what is not true. We love you, Lord, and we seek you now in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, Brother Merle, take it away. All right, last week we were supposed to talk about total depravity. We kind of overflowed into the other points of TULIP. Tonight, Matt and I are going to discuss unconditional election. We're sitting in the studio pre-recording this. And or echoing the sentiment that God unconditionally elects some to salvation, a reiteration, in my opinion, of total depravity and the need for God to step in and save without any... Hold it right there. It was a slight glitch in the back room, so to speak. And so that was the unconditional election, that the U of the TULIP, and we're trying to drum up the I of the TULIP, which is irresistible grace. Do we have it up yet? No. Not yet. We're looking for it. Uh-oh. It could be lost. Then what are we going to do?
This loss is not grace anymore.
As an ex-JW and an ex-LDS, I was taught and scriptures seem to support that the earth should have been a paradise. Does it mean that Adam and Eve would have lived forever on earth in a paradise? I would like to see you do a series on heaven. God bless you in your ministry. Without it, I'd be spiritually lost. I don't know who said that, but it comes from somebody. I believe that, yes, that a garden was would have continued to be a paradise, similar to the paradise that we go to when we die. And I believe that Adam and Eve could have had children, and they could have asked God, how do we make children? He would have told them, look at the animals, and they would have had children in that paradise and the propagation. But God knew that sin would come in with the first man, and he knows all things. And so he made ways for that to be reconciled in the end. And that's what Jesus did, reconciled us to a paradise state in our hearts, part of a paradise kingdom that we're going to go to ultimately. Next one, in all honesty, with Calvinist limited atonement really should apply only to the Jews. Since we know that God came to save the whole world, then it's not limited, because not just the Jews are saved. Calvinism is really confusing to me when my faith is in the plainness of God's word. I don't know who that was from either, but it's up on the screen, and I'm hoping that Matt will be able to answer that question. Listen, if limited atonement should really apply to the Jews, since atonement doesn't apply only to the Jews, how could it be limited? I think I'm translating it the right way. We just found the clip. Here we go. All right, the fourth point of five-point Calvinism is known as irresistible grace or efficacious grace. As a quick reminder, and this is just a summary because we're in a new show, point one is man is totally unable to choose God on his own for salvation. I see scripture as saying that man is willful, he's sinful, he's a creature, but certainly not totally depraved. Point two is God elects some to be his unconditionally. The elect do nothing nor possess anything to merit being elected. I agree that he redeems unconditionally, but don't see receiving his redemption as a work that a man could boast. All I see it as is being willing to open a door. And that to me is not something we boast about. Point three is Jesus' atonement is applied to the elect alone and not to the world. I believe Jesus paid for the sins of the whole world. And because of this, the whole world will be redeemed ultimately, not saved, but reconciled to God through whatever measures he has foreordained and put in place, because he is a loving God and he knew beforehand the choices and the direction most of us were going to go. And it's all through Christ Jesus. And then the fourth point says that when God steps in and elects a person, that election is wholly effective. It is complete. Okay? And from the Calvinist view, efficacious grace is an immediate, miraculous transformation of man's nature. And in an instant, the totally depraved sinner who has been unable and unwilling to make the slightest move toward God is given a new nature from God. He's born again into life he never sought, he never desired. This is the important part to understand about efficacious grace, because anybody who's been born again knows that he steps in and he gives a new heart and he changes you and he saves you. And anybody who experienced that realizes that is true. But the important thing to understand about Calvinistic efficacious grace is that it is given before a person can believe. Those in a state of total inability cannot do anything toward God because we're totally unable. So in Calvinism, it makes sense that God would have to step in and present his grace before the person can say, I believe. The Westminster Confession, a Reformed confession, says, quote, all those whom God has predestined unto life, and those only, he is pleased in his appointed and accepted time effectually to call by his word and spirit out of that state of death into which they are by nature, to grace and salvation by Jesus Christ, enlightening their minds spiritually and savingly, to understand the things of God, taking away their heart of stone and giving them a heart of flesh, renewing their wills, and by his almighty power determining them to that which is good and effectually drawing them to Jesus Christ, yet so as they must come most freely, being made willing by his grace. The Calvinistic doctrine leaves many questions for me unanswered, and in its wake, I believe, has created one heck of a non-biblical premise for millions of Christians worldwide. And we're going to talk more about that when we talk about perseverance of the saints. But first of all, we have to ask, where does the Bible ever teach that God must regenerate a man's nature before he can believe? Where does the Bible teach that God must regenerate a man's nature before he can believe? That's my question. While the man-made teaching is certainly consistent with five-point Calvinism and total inability, it's certainly consistent with total inability, it does not seem to be supported by any real passage of Scripture. Maybe Matt will come up and prove me wrong, but I want to see a passage that says he has to step in and convert us before we can believe. All a person has to do is read the New and Old Testament narratives of people who hear invitations to follow God and ask, did God regenerate them before they could choose to accept an invitation, or did they choose to open the door and receive him? That's what we have to ask. What does the Scripture present to us? Are people walking along? Now, there's a caveat that the Calvinists can use, and that is, well, he's doing it. If somebody decided to follow Jesus, it's because God gave him that instantaneous, efficacious grace. And we can say all that, but I want to see Scripture that tells us that that's what happens, and that's the reason that they followed. Because if we can see Scripture that says, and the only reason those who followed him was because God efficaciously changed them in an instant and gave them the power to do so, then I would believe it. But what I see is Jesus using methods with the woman at the well. I see people teaching. I see preaching. I hear people who are listening, and some are wondering, well, what about this? And slowly they're being led into it. Now, the Calvinists could say, well, that's because God, he's changed them. They just don't know it yet. But just give me the Scripture that proves that. When did God grant Abraham a new nature before he made the decision to leave Ur of the Chaldees? I mean, did he grant that, or did Abraham choose to leave Ur of Chaldees? If the call was irresistible, why does the Bible praise Abraham's faith? They say it was by his faith. It wouldn't be by that faith. It would be by the fact that the Bible would say, and God touched Abraham, and Abraham then was able to believe and did. But we don't read that. We just read that Abraham believed. If God made him do it, what he did, why the praise for doing something so totally passive? Absolutely passive. Leaving the Ur of Chaldees. All through the New Testament, the authors of Scripture attribute the new birth or regeneration, they attribute it all through to the hearing of the word, not by an instantaneous action that precedes faith. That's a man-made idea. We can twist things, we can use Scripture here and there, but it's a man-made idea. The Scripture plainly teaches that the word is taught, and people say, and they start to hear. James 1:8 says, he chose to give us birth through the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. Talking about the church and believers being first fruits. In the nation of Israel, there was a first fruit harvest, and all that went to God. Then there was a giant harvest that followed of the rest of the orchard. And then there was a gleaning of the harvest of all that remained. We are the first fruits, James says, of many creatures. Many. We're not just the only ones. We're not just like the Jews who say, we're the elect, leave us alone, we're the chosen ones of God. We are not alone. We have a whole world out there that God is calling to. We're the first fruits of his creation. 1 Peter 1:23 says, For you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of the imperishable, through the living and enduring Word of God. It is by the hearing of the Word that we say. Now, maybe the Calvinist says, well, when they hear the Word, they are immediately given this transformation of this efficacious grace and are able to suddenly believe it. There's the debate. They would have to say that if you believe in total depravity. But if you say, you know, God is calling, we're not totally depraved, there's an ability to hear, like I think we proved last night in Scripture, that people are able to hear, and they're able to open the door or not, I think that it opens the door for saying, hey, listen, you can believe first and then have God change your heart. This is where all the debate lies. It is the preaching of the gospel in most cases, not all. God never, he rarely gives us an all, because he wants this tension between us. But in most cases, the preaching of the gospel and the hearing of the gospel that God has established to get people to believe, not puppeteering of God, taking depraved Pinocchio and turning him into a son. Calvinists will sometimes use the conversion of Lydia in Acts 16:14 to prove the Calvinist point of irresistible grace, because Scripture tells us that Lydia, it doesn't work, she was already a worshiper of God. So we can't use that example. She was not a totally depraved corpse when she came to believe. The picture of Lazarus being raised from the dead is often tempted to use to prove the point of total depravity and irresistible grace, that he was laying there dead in the grave and Jesus called him forth. But two points about that. One, he followed Jesus first. He was already following Jesus. And two, it was the Word spoken that got Lazarus to come back to life. It's the Word. The Calvinist says it is this imputation of Almighty Sovereign God into people that allows them to then believe. And I just think that that's not consistent with what the Bible says. Plus, in other words, passages that speak of God changing a man's heart or giving someone a new one do not necessarily support the Calvinist doctrine of efficacious grace. It is not uncommon for Scripture to speak of man's inability to do things without divine influence, but it doesn't mean that men are completely passive. This is this mountain you have to stand on to embrace all this. In my estimation, there seems to be a reciprocity going on in Scripture. God is calling, man is responding or not, and will reap accordingly. Draw near to God, he will draw near to you. Now, I realize that was given to believers, but nevertheless, I believe it holds for anyone. Certainly, the heart of man needs a heart toward God and his righteousness. But we have to honestly admit that while sometimes the Bible tells us that God changes the heart, it also shows how there are times when an individual changes their heart. Both are true in Scripture. We do have passages like Deuteronomy 36 that seem to support the Calvinist stance. It says, "The Lord your God will circumcise your hearts and your hearts of your descendants, so that you may love him with all your heart and with all your soul and live." I agree with that. The Lord does that sometimes. But conversely, Jeremiah 4:4 says, "Circumcise yourselves to the Lord. Circumcise your hearts, you men of Judah and people of Jerusalem." We have both being presented, both options. Inspired texts speak of the divine side and the human side. Again, Psalms 119:36, the psalmist asks that his heart might be inclined by God toward keeping the commandments. He prays that his heart might be there. How is he doing that? But later on in the same psalm, verse 112, the writer says that he had inclined his own heart to do it. He had inclined his own heart. There is a freedom. Another problem I have with Calvinism is that, in my opinion, God being good and merciful and just is a God of liberty and freedom. He is not a God of tyranny. He is not a God that forces anything, anything. He does get his way. He will have his ways, but he doesn't force it. It is through free will and drawing and loving. And if people come to him by faith and love, fine. If they come to him by hell and lake of fire, whatever it's gonna be. But bottom line, he will have his way. And it's not by force of any sort. I'm convinced that in an effort to systemize the biblical message, so to offer certainty to people, They want a system. We live for systems because they give us certainty and they allow us to have comfort. And the proponents of certainty are the most popular. You be a proponent of we're not sure, and you will find your audiences dwindle, because by nature we want concrete answers to everything. Calvinism gives this in a system, but the system fails. There is simply far too many counterexamples to every one of the steps to allow for this system to be completely right. God has allowed for such paradoxes to exist, providing ample examples from his inspired word for other views to find a home. That's been the message. Other views are viable. I read, I believe, with the same urgency, ardent nature, the word of God. I was transformed at the side of the road, and it changed my life. I asked him, I was broken. My life was changed. I opened the door. I did no works. I can't boast of it. Why he chose me, like Matt said, I don't know. He does that. He's willing to do it for all. His son suffered so it can be available to all. And he is a God of love who is not coercing things and not limiting things. He is making it open to everybody. And that's the beautiful message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So I hope we can continue to have the dialogues and learn to get along. Matt Slick is up next. Matt Slick is up now.
John has attempted to refute the idea of irresistible grace. Now, Sean and I get along off camera, so I can tease him a little bit. But what is irresistible grace? This is TULIP, total depravity, unconditional election, limited atonement, irresistible grace. What does irresistible grace mean? Well, unfortunately, the phrase kind of suggests a forcible kind of a yanking you in, you're kicking and screaming, and he makes you believe. That's not what the phrase irresistible grace means. What it really means is that when it's time for regeneration, when it's time for you to be born again, you cannot successfully resist that effort of God to change you and make you a new creature in Christ, 2 Corinthians 5:17. That God brings you to that place of faith. He brings you to that place of faith because he regenerates you. So irresistible grace is the grace that God gives that cannot be successfully resisted at this issue and time of being born again. That's what it's dealing with. It does not mean that during a person's life that they might resist God. I did. It doesn't mean that they might want something else besides God, want some sin. That certainly was my case. That's not what irresistible grace means. When it's time for you to be born again, God in his great spiritual movement causes you to be born again. 1 Peter 1:3. God causes that you're born again. You don't cause it yourself. Now think about this. If you're caused to be born again because of your faith, let's say that you believe and that causes you to be born again. Well, wait a minute. Who does the regeneration? Is it you? Is it this thing called faith? Or is it God himself? Does God himself reach, so to speak, into you and change you? Does he live in you, as it says, Jesus says in John 14, 23, the Father and he will come and make their abode in you. Or you can go to John 3, 3 through 8, where Jesus says the Spirit comes and he lives in us and we are born again. Does this happen because we believe? That God is waiting on the outside of our hearts, on the outside of our souls and saying, look, please just believe. I'm urging you. Because a lot of times what I'll say is, this is the blonde-haired, blue-eyed Caucasian surfer Jesus who's dressed in a woman's nightgown, standing at the door of your heart, asking permission to come in. Please, can you just let me in? Because, you know, I want to save you, but it's up to you and your wisdom. It's up to you and your ability. It's up to you and your will, and I'm just out here. And when you believe, then I'll come in and I'll make you born again. That's wishful thinking. It is unbiblical. It's man-centered, it's idolatrous, it's heretical. See, the Bible says God causes us to be born again. Now, I want to read a couple of verses here to John 1, 12 and 13. I want you to understand what God says about this thing. This is what it says. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to be called the children of God, those who believe in his name, who were born. Now, the context is talking about being born again. who are born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man. You get that? It specifically says, nor of the will of man. If it's true that you have to believe before you get regenerated, then that verse can't be there. You're born, and it's talking about being born again and believing in God and receiving Christ, who are born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man. Not of the will of man. Now, John 9:14, God is talking through Paul, the apostle, in 9:14. I really suggest you study verses 9 through 23. But in verse 14, he says, it does not depend upon the man who wills or the man who runs, but upon God who has mercy. It specifically states not because of the man. Just as John 1:13 says, not because of the will of the man. It specifically states it. And because it specifically states it, you should believe it. You should believe what it says. Now, Sean asked a question, and I wrote it down, so I can find this question quickly here. Show me a passage that says God has to step in first in order to save them before they can be saved. Well, we don't want to say, show me a passage that says that you have to wear a shirt on Tuesday that's blue. It's like saying, show me a passage, and I'm going to give a narrow construct, and it has to fit this construct in order for it to be true. That's not how we do things. What we're supposed to do is say, what does the Scripture teach? We draw conclusions out of what it says. Does it say that God changes us? Yes, it does. Does it say He causes us to be born again? 1 Peter 1:3. Yes, it does. Does He say He does it not by our will, but by His will? Yes, He does. John 1:13. Does He say it does not depend upon the will of man, but upon the will of God? Yes, it does. John 9:14. Does it also say that Jesus says in John 6:44, you cannot come to me unless the Father draws you? And that word draw in the Greek is also translated into the word drag. You can't come to me unless He is dragging you in. In John 6:65, this grace of God, you cannot come to me, Jesus says, unless it's been granted to you from the Father. Now notice what it says. You cannot come to me unless it's been granted to you by God the Father. Now wait a minute. If it's merely up to the individual to believe, then why did Jesus say, you can't come to me unless it's been granted to you from the Father? Why would He say that? You cannot. If it's of your own will, and if your faith gets you regenerated, then it would not be true that you cannot come to me unless it's been granted to you from the Father. That means the regenerative work. What we say, and I did this before, we say regeneration precedes faith. We don't say faith precedes regeneration. But don't make the mistake of thinking it's temporal. That is a temporal of order. Like, I clap my hands here, I clap my hands here. First and second, roughly a second between them. That's what we talk about, temporal order. That's not what's being spoken of in Reformed theology when we say that that regeneration precedes faith. Now think about this. Let's look at it temporally. If faith precedes regeneration, as in, let's just say 2 seconds. And I'm not going to say it is 2 seconds or not 2 seconds, but just for the sake of argument, so that we can get a little grasp on this. If it's you believe and then 2 seconds later you're regenerated, then what you have is, for 2 seconds, is you have someone who's a believer who's also not regenerated. That's a problem. Now let's reverse those and look at the temporal context. Let's say you're regenerated and 2 seconds later then you believe. Well, that's a problem because then you have a regenerated person for a period of time who's not even a believer, and that can't work. What we say in Reformed theology is that we say it's a logical progression. I went over this before. I'll do it again here. Is that regeneration precedes faith logically, not temporally. The illustration I use is a light bulb. Whenever you flip a switch and electricity is present in the light bulb, then light is automatically the result of that electricity. Faith is automatically the result of that regeneration. When God irresistibly, through His grace, changes you, the result is that you will believe. That's why it says you're born again not of your own will, John 1:13. It does not depend upon the man who wills or the man who runs, but upon God who has mercy, Romans 9:14. Or that He brought us into the faith by the exertion of His will, James 1:18. This is by the work of God. And Sean quoted Lydia in Acts 16:14. And what that says there is that God opened her mind to respond to the things spoken of by Paul. She had to have her mind opened. Jesus even says in Luke 24:45, where it says there in Luke, that he opened the minds of the disciples so they would understand the scripture. This is what God does. He grants that we believe, Philippians 1:29. He works the believing in us, John 6:28-29. Now, this is what's interesting. People will say, no, in their depravity, they're the ones able to believe. They're the ones able to, and then it results in regeneration. Well, wait a minute. The Bible says this is the work of God that you believe on whom he has sent. It's not the work of man. God does it. And the reason you believe is because of the work of God changing you. The reason you do is because in his irresistible grace, when it's time for you to be born again, he draws you and he changes you. You cannot successfully resist that because it's God and you're simply a sinner. You're simply a weak creature who cannot thwart the will and the sovereign decree of God when he calls you into his kingdom. That's what irresistible grace means. It's perfectly scriptural, it's consistent with scripture, and it's logical. Now, again, I want to focus a little bit on this one issue. A lot of people like the idea that it's up to them to believe. It's up to them to believe. And I ask people this question. Those who resist this idea of irresistible grace, the people who say, no, it's not true, I ask them, you believed, right? Yes. Do you take credit for your believing? It's a question I ask them. Do you take credit for it? I've actually had some say, oh, of course I take credit for believing. I say, okay, let me ask you. So before you became a Christian, you were a slave of sin, a hater of God, who could do no good, and you loved evil instead of righteousness. You're full of evil, and you just was able to believe in the wisdom of your own heart. I've had people say, yes. I say, well, we call that pride. We call that pride. Look how good I was, even in the midst of my sin, I was able to choose God. People take credit for their own believing, and you know, they just walk around and they sit there like that. Yeah, you know, hey, I was wise enough to pick God, but you were not. Now, I'm not trying to mock people who hold that position, because most aren't like that in a boastful, arrogant kind of a way. But sometimes what I'd like to do is exaggerate to make a point. Is it in your own heart that if you're the kind of a person who would say, yes, in my wisdom, in my unbelief, I was capable, and I'm the one who chose, and God responded to my choice. Is that what's going on in your heart and your mind? If that's the case, search your heart, search your mind to see if there's any pride there. I'm not accusing you, but ask the question of yourself. See if you're saying something to the effect of, Lord, thank you for not making me like that other person over there that I was able to choose, that I was able to see. We have to be careful that we're not prideful and arrogant. Now, I'm not pointing fingers at you without pointing at myself. You know what? I got a lot of pride and a lot of arrogance. My wife will tell you, my friends will tell you that's the case. And I'm saved only by the grace of God, and I'm kept by the grace of God. And that's just how it is. But here's the thing. God irresistibly draws us. He irresistibly changes us. And the scriptures, as I've already declared already, clearly tell us we're caused to be born again. 1 Peter 1:3. Just look in the NASB Bible. You'll see it's what it says. We don't cause ourselves to be born again. We don't cause the regeneration to be because we believe, where God is waiting in the wings, just knocking on the door of your heart. Please let me in. Please let me in. It's up to you. It's up to your wisdom. But then why would Jesus say, you can't even come to me unless the Father draws you? You can't even come to me unless it's been granted to you from the Father, John 6:65. If it's up to him just knocking the door of your heart, please let me in. Then why does it say, you can't come to me unless it's been granted to you from God the Father? Why would he say, to you it has been granted to believe? It's been granted. Who granted it to you? God. The reason you believe is because of what God has done in you. The reason you believe and you love God is because of what God has done in you. Give him all the glory. It doesn't mean that you're special. It means that you are a receiver of the grace of God. It's actually humbling to believe this. It's actually, well, humbling. Why would God give you that? Don't know. I'm a man who shook his fist up in the air at God, yelling at him to leave him alone. Leave me alone, Lord. Yet God is using me. If God had listened to my will and my sinfulness, I wouldn't be here. I'd be in hell one way or another. But God in his mercy called me forth. God in his mercy and his grace made me born again. God in his mercy loved me before the foundation of the world, knowing completely what I am internally. And he loves me in spite of me. He loves me because of who he is. So when it came time for me to be born again, God irresistibly changed me. His grace came upon me, and I was born again. And I understood who he was. I understood that the word was his. I understood that I was a sinner saved by grace. It's not something I boast about. It's not something I say, look at me, I'm a chosen person, I'm elected, I'm great. On the contrary, why did he save me? I don't know. Why does he use me? I don't know. I'm not good enough. I'm not wise enough. I'm not smart enough. But he is good and he is wise. He knows all things. And he decided to condescend to my level and use a broken vessel full of pride and arrogance, full of sin, full of covetousness, and send me to be used in his mission for his glory. And he receives all the glory. He irresistibly changed me. His grace could not be successfully resisted by my sinful heart. That's what irresistible grace is. It's biblical. It's right there in Scripture. I just ask you, look at the Scriptures and look at your heart. Were you wise enough? Were you good enough to make the choice? Or did God change your nature? And the result of that change of the nature is that you believed. He didn't force you. He changed you, made a new creature out of you, 2 Corinthians 5:17, and then you were enabled to believe by him, and you freely chose to believe because of his regenerative work. That's what I believe. That's what I hope you do too. Amen.
Okay, welcome back. We're working to get Matt up on the phone through Skype or whatever it is. And in the meantime, get your questions ready. We have some questions on the screen. I have some questions here. And then he and I will also do some talking. But first, let's take a look at this.
Okay, you only cleared up in the last 3 seconds of what you were saying. Ezekiel, what? Whoa. I'm slick, but not that slick. I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, anyone who dies. The Shaphat's in the Hebrew, and actually God does take pleasure in the death of the wicked in other areas. I can take you to, hold on a sec, I wasn't prepped for this one, but I can find it pretty quickly. Yes.
Yeah, and he says, I will take pleasure in destroying you. And let me, I think I got it right here. Let's see. Let's see. For the Lord hardened his spirit. I'm sorry, I'm going to go through this as quickly as I can find. Yeah, I take no pleasure in the death of the wicked, Ezekiel 33:11, and also 18:32. But you can go to, I mean, I'm not setting scripture against scripture, but we have to take a totality of scripture. Deuteronomy 28:63, the Lord will delight over you to make you perish and destroy you. 1 Samuel 2:25, the Lord desired to put him to death. The word desired there is shafat. It's the same word used in Ezekiel 18:32 and 33:11. The word as translated as pleasure. It means to delight in, to take pleasure in, to desire, to be pleased with. So context is always the solution. And we just have to go through the context. To be honest, I haven't studied these contexts in a while to be able to give you an accurate, what I would say is an accurate assessment. And that reminds me, I'm going to make a correction. I was quoting Romans 9:16. I just got my verses mixed up a couple times. I was listening to myself earlier. No, it's not Romans.
The difference.
Well, you're looking it up and going, hey, he doesn't know it. It's, we all do that.
Hey, do we have another question for the screen? Ladies? Okay, another one coming up here, Matt, and then I have some here. This okay. One says, I'm waiting. All right, oh, here it is. After listening to his drive, I can understand why there were reformers who came after Calvin. He's overcome with intellectualism his own. Matt creates a false or slightly false premise and then mounts a reasoned argument against it, but his premise was false to begin with. This is from Bill in Boise, Idaho. I don't know. I didn't read this beforehand, Matt. Any comments?
Yeah, when someone says, look, I'm overcome with intellectualism, that is nothing more than just an opinion. It's an attack on the character. Look, I'm overcome with intellectualism. I could say, well, you asked a question because you're overcome with emotionalism. It doesn't really get us very far, and it doesn't really carry any weight. When he says it's a slightly false premise, it's either false or it's not false. We don't have slightly false things. We have something that's false or it's not false. That's just the logic. And is it wrong to be intellectual? Not at all. God says, let us reason together. He said, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Jesus says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind. Paul in Acts 17 reasoned, dialegomai, dialogued, and he used reason to move the people. Now, I could take this and segue into the idea that, unfortunately, there's an anti-intellectualism that's pervasive in the Christian church, and it has cost us a great deal when people start trusting their emotions and sentiment above the mind, because God says, be transformed by the renewing of your mind, not by your feelings and your heart, your emotionalism. So the question really isn't well-formed, no offense, Matt. It needs to be more precise and biblically based.
Okay, so Matt, that leads me into a question, because you said this is an opinion, and so you can't really trust in opinions. There are other forms of Calvinism, for instance, hyper-Calvinism, right?
That's a heresy. We Calvinists consider hyper-Calvinism to be heretical, because what it says is that you don't have to go out and witness, you don't have to do evangelism, you do nothing at all, because God will just bring people into salvation. It doesn't really matter what you do. Well, obviously, that's not biblical. So, through the show so far, right or wrong, you see me quote an awful lot of scripture. Well, I try and be scriptural. And the Bible tells us to go evangelize. The Bible tells us to go witness. And hyper-Calvinists who just disobey that command, they're not following scripture. They're using it as an excuse to do nothing. Let me tell you, even Calvinists mess up.
Okay. So there are differences, and you just said hyper-Calvinism is heretical. Of course, the hyper-Calvinists believe they have justification for their stances, whatever they may be, and as erroneous as you think they are. The question is, I'm trying to understand, really what you're asking us to do is to believe your interpretation of Scripture. The hyper-Calvinist is asking us to believe theirs. I'm asking people to consider mine. Arminius say the same. So, Matt, when we're all doing that, in the end, isn't it really up to the individual and the spirit and their desire to know the truth?
Well, Romans 14, 1 through 12 says that we are not to divide and cast judgment over debatable issues. Now, you might not hear too many Calvinists say what I'm going to say, and I may get some flack for this, but the 5 points of Calvinism are a systemized understanding of Scripture based on a lot of Scripture, based on what seems to be there. But it does not mean that everything that Calvinism teaches in all its areas is always correct. What we have to do is look at what the Word of God says. Now, I say even we Calvinists are going to be corrected when we get to heaven. We, you know, sometimes I like to say we have God in a doctrinal box and don't want to let him out. Well, the thing is, I've met Calvinists. I'm like, are you kidding me? How can you think that? Why don't you not go out and witness? Why don't you go out and do it? But almost all, for example, all the open-air preachers I know are five-point Calvinists.
Yeah.
They're out there witnessing all the time. Mm-hmm. They're going out and doing it because they believe the totality of Scripture, et cetera. But anyway, back to Romans 14. We're not to pass judgment on people who have differences of opinions. So people say they're not Calvinists. I don't care. As long as they believe in the essentials of the Christian faith, that's what I'm concerned about. I preach Jesus and Him crucified. That's the essential. But not the 5 points of Calvinism. That's not an essential matter. Even though some Calvinists will say the 5 points of Calvinism is the same thing as the gospel, which I disagree with.
Okay. So I'm really glad to hear you say that we don't divide on disputable matters. Praise God, coming from Matt Slick. And I find the tenor of most of your arguments on CARM to support that. But let me ask you, Matt, so then, and I'm allowing you to bring up the different words that, you know, but what are, in your estimation, the irrefutable, and you mentioned this on your site, doctrines of Christianity that are to be disputed and fought over in terms of knowing whether someone's a Christian or not? And summarize those as quickly as possible.
I'll do as quick as I can. If you go to CARM and you look up essential doctrines of Christianity, you can see what's there. And I'm going to close the door here while I'm talking to you. I have a wireless mic. I have what's called a differentiation of essential versus non-essential doctrines. Essential or primary and secondary, excuse me. Primary and secondary essentials. Primary essentials are those essentials the Bible declares are essential.
Okay, so primary essentials here, folks. Primary essentials, okay.
Are those that God in the Word has declared are essential. For example, Jesus says, unless you believe that I am, you will die in your sins. That's John 8:24.
Okay.
That's it. It's got a statement with a warning on it. You go to 1 Corinthians 15:14. If Christ be not raised, our faith is in vain. So there are at least five like this. And I won't take too much time going through all the scriptures, but the deity of Christ is one of them. It's got the verse, salvation by grace. You go to Romans 5 on that one with the warning about faith alone. The resurrection of Christ, which I mentioned. The gospel out of Galatians 1:8-9. If we aren't, you know, preach the gospel contrary, we preach that and be accursed. Monotheism, believing in the true and living God. And that's out of Exodus 20, okay. The Ten Commandments. Now, what I call the secondary essentials are the essentials that follow out of those. For example, the deity of Christ, you really can't defend that if you don't believe in the virgin birth, for example, in Matthew 1:25. But there's no place in Scripture that says the virgin birth is an essential doctrine, or if thou dost believe in the virgin birth, thou shalt burn in hell. It doesn't say anything like that in place. And then the doctrine of the Trinity is also what I call a secondary essential in the faith. It's not explicitly declared in Scripture, but it seems to be derivatively arrived at. So I go with the primaries, and you can go to the website. And also, you know, Jesus says, for example, in John 14:6, on the way, the truth, and life, no one comes to the Father but through me. Well, that's a secondary, by my definition, because there's no curse applied to it. But it's a statement that it's the only way. So, you know, is it a primary or secondary? It's kind of one foot in both, if you get what I'm saying.
Makes sense? I get it.
Yeah.
Okay, here's a question, again, from Idaho. Interesting that he states that Calvinists won't be corrected until they get to heaven. Is he suggesting they aren't teachable in this life? LOL, it appears so. We have comics out there, Matt. They're comedians. So smile with it.
Yeah, I never said we won't be corrected until. I said all of us are going to be corrected when we get to heaven.
Okay.
And when someone I consider things like that to be it's a misrepresentation and a personal attack.
Okay. Matt, I get that. Listen, let me ask you something. I want to talk to you about freedom.
Sure.
Part of my problem with the explanation of Calvinism about God and total depravity and unconditional election and irresistible grace and perseverance of the saints is it doesn't allow for what I would say is the freedom of an individual to say, I accept or I reject. To me, it's no different than a mad scientist who forces his creature, Frankenstein, to be what he wants him to be, or a government, or a husband, or a parent. I have a real problem with our God, who gives better gifts than we do and is love, being a God who despotically, in my opinion, he comes in and he says, I've elected. So the question I have for you from that, and then you can talk all you want on what it just said, is does someone who God has elected have the right to say no?
Well, that's kind of a tricky question. Elected, yeah, they have the right to say no, in the sense that their freedom is going to allow them to say no until they're regenerated, because you can have someone who's an atheist who's elected to be saved and will come to the faith later on, and they're rejecting in the meantime. Whether or not they have a right, does that mean they have a legal right to disobey God? Then we have to say, no, they don't. No,
not a legal right, but in other words, can somebody whom God points at and says, you are mine, say, forget it?
Yeah, people do it all the time in that they reject God. Unbelievers reject God all the time.
What about
Christians don't do that.
Okay, so I'm sorry, but again, God has his elect. He has elected them.
Yes.
By his sovereignty, when
right,
he points to that person, can anybody say no?
You mean can anybody
reject it?
Actually, God and not be elected? And
yeah,
not be
actually
saved?
Say, I don't want your election.
That's like, no, you can't say you don't want your. Well, okay, there's a technical yes and no. I'm a little more precise than most people. Can an unbeliever who believes that the law with the Bible is, say, an atheist who'd say, I don't care about God's election, I don't want it, and actually be elect? That's possible, because he could be rejecting the truth until God has worked on him and changed him, and then he believes. So can a person say that? I'm
not
sure
say.
A person could say it.
Not say, I mean it.
And mean it, sure.
And have his way.
No.
Okay.
Well, they have their way until God decides they're going to be regenerated. Then
okay.
You cannot resist him.
He cannot. So it's irresistible, right?
That's what that means. When it's time
okay.
for you to be regenerated, you don't have a say in that. God does that. And you don't have a say in your election. God chose you before the foundation of the world. You weren't around to make a decision.
Okay,
but
let
me respond to you. When
okay.
you said it doesn't allow for freedom of the individual to accept, well, why is that the right standard?
I'm not saying I just want to, I'm just trying to understand, Matt. So
okay,
I'm just trying to understand.
Sure.
So
let me help.
Jesus asked us to pray that eyes would be open, ears would be unclogged,
yes.
hearts would feel, and told
yep.
people to believe, oh, you faithless, all those commands we've talked about. But what you are suggesting to me is a God who he says, you're all depraved. I will pick, elect certain, and there is no way they can refuse my election. To me, that has the basis in a really scary, despotic God, which does not coincide with my understanding of what love is, which woos and is long-suffering and patient and works with, like a husband with a wife or a father with a child. I don't understand this view where God, who is better than all of us, is given this attribute that to me is so reprehensible. Does that make sense from how
yes.
I'm trying to explain it?
Yes.
Okay.
But what that does is it presupposes that the unbeliever can choose to believe in God if he's wooed by God. The Bible
okay.
says the unbeliever cannot receive the things of God for their foolishness to him, 1 Corinthians 2:14. He will not receive them. He does not seek for God, Romans 3:10, 11, and 12. The wooing issue, and then if God woos enough, then they'll kind of come to it. It's never a biblical option. It doesn't say that. In fact, the scriptures definitely declare the opposite. You know, John 6:65, you cannot come to me unless it's been granted to you from the Father. And this is what Jesus says, and these are absolute statements.
I get that. And I think, but I don't understand why we can't understand is that God is wooing all. But in the Old Testament, it seems like there's a lot of passages where God woos. Like where the prophet he speaks to the prophet, he says Israel, you're a whore, you've done this, you've done that, you've done this, and then I'm going to treat her kindly and I'm going to bring her in. And doesn't Scripture say that it's the goodness of God that leads to repentance?
Romans 2:4. In the Old Testament, God proclaims and requires various things to the covenant people. He's talking to the nation of Israel. And he has covenanted with Israel. That's why he says in Matthew 15:24, Jesus says he was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. He wasn't sent to everybody, only to the nation of Israel. That's what he said, Matthew 15:24.
Okay.
And so that has to do with the covenant people that he's talking to. But, you know, God does elect people. That's what the word to choose is election. 2 Thessalonians 2:13. He chose us for salvation.
Yeah.
Acts 13:48. As many as had been appointed to eternal life believed. See, to be honest, I wouldn't have written the Bible this way. To be honest, I would have done it differently. I'd have said, no, it's up to our free will. But when I read the Scriptures, it says we're caused to be born again, 1 Peter 1:3. You can't come to me unless it's been granted you from the Father, John 6:65. You're born again not of your own will, John 1:13. I had to believe that we had to be regenerated by God first.
See, Matt, when you say sentences like, I would rewrite it differently, or I would, I always have the opposite opinion of that. I always think that I could never construct something as beautiful as what God has done, and I would create something far more sinister, not something that would be better.
No, I mean, I wouldn't have put in the idea, because I'm a human being who likes to make theology out of my experience. I like the idea of God being loving and wooing, and I'm the one who has the wisdom in my own heart to choose. That sounds natural. And when I first became a Christian, that's what I believed, because I believed my own experience as the foundation for making Christian theology. Mm. And then when I started reading Scripture, I remember I was in college, at a Lutheran college, and a professor, this is for real, professor said God predestines people. I raised my hand. I said, no, he doesn't. And he looked at me and goes, yes, he does. I said, no, he does not in class. Yeah. He said, well, tell you what, come after class, I'll give you some verses. Okay. After class, he gave me some verses. I went home and studied them. I came back to class next day and said, I need to apologize publicly. Yeah. You know, because this is what it said. He gave me the verses. It's what it says. We tend as people to make doctrine out of our experiences and our preferences. We tend not to submit to the Word of God.
Okay, Matt, let me ask you one final thing. We're out of time.
Sure.
In the parable of the prodigal son, and this seems to be more in harmony with my thinking than what you're describing. The father, he had a son who went and spent his living, a riotous living, his inheritance, and it was only when he came to himself, it says, and he was there eating the husks of corn that the pigs were eating, that he said to himself, you know, my father, I can go back and be a servant in his house and be better off. And it says when he came to himself, he made the decision, and then he rehearses the things he's going to say to his father as he returns. And as he chose to return from that slop, the father ran to him. Can you explain that relative to what you're saying?
Yeah, the parable is not about free will exercise and the issues of regeneration. The older son represented the Jews, the younger son represented the Gentiles. And it has a great deal of cultural importance. So it's not an appropriate place to go to for the idea to refute irresistible grace.
Okay, now again, and I respect your interpretation of it, but I see it as definitely I agree with you what it represents in terms of the nation of Israel and them always being with him and then the disobedient Gentiles. But you're suggesting that when you read that, there's no other application to millions of people who have had prodigals?
No, I would say that generically speaking, a parable isn't a place you want to go to make a doctrine when Scripture says very clearly such things as the unbeliever cannot receive the things of God for their foolishness to him, 1 Corinthians 2:14. You know, if you go to a parable, which is meant to illustrate a main point, and it's not about irresistible grace, to say, look, this is what it says here, so let's ignore the very clear teaching of faith, say 1 Corinthians 2:14, the unbeliever cannot understand or receive these things.
Okay, an unbeliever can't, but it doesn't say anything about God having to make them a believer before they can. So we could go off on that.
Regeneration. What we say is that God is the one who works faith in us. John 6:20-29. They said,
I would
Jesus,
agree.
What must we do to work the works of God? And Jesus says, this is the work of God, that you
believe
on whom he has sent.
Right. I agree with you, that you believe. That's to do the work of God.
God works it that you do. We Calvinists don't say you guys don't believe and that you don't have free will. We say that the free will of the unbeliever is a slave of sin. He's going to always choose sinful things. God works in him, changes him, and then he freely believes and chooses God.
Right. Regarding, we're going to wrap up with this. Sorry, staff, and we're going over a little bit. next week is Perseverance of the Saint. Would you agree that's once saved, always saved, Matt?
Basically, functionally, yes.
Okay. And then after that, maybe we'll have more discussions and dialogues on this. But regarding let me ask you this final question. This really interests me with you, because what takes precedence when it comes to understanding Scripture? The written word or the Holy Spirit guiding the reader?
The Holy Spirit will, it's a false dichotomy. The Holy Spirit will always bear witness of Christ and will never lead us in a manner contrary to the Word of God that he authored. So we don't want to set up a thing that we have these opposing ideas. If they're opposing, it's because we're failing in our own hearts.
Right, so they would never oppose each other.
That's correct.
Right. So when I read that parable, which you say we don't use parables to establish doctrine, and I read that of the prodigal son, and I believe that the Holy Spirit is suggesting to me that when we're dealing with people who are lost to the world, that they have to come to their own senses before they're going to be able to return to the Father without any intervention of the Father at all. Would you say that I'm incorrect in that assumption and that the Holy Spirit has taught me a false dichotomy?
I'd have to look at what you're saying in more detail.
Okay.
And
I'm just curious about how that works.
Well, it's just an issue of biblical interpretation and proper ways of doing that. Not that I got it down right. You know, I'm not going to say, you come to me, I tell you how to interpret everything properly. You know, we have certain principles, we have certain things, and there's some parables I love that it just teach some great doctrines. But, you know, like, for example, the doctrine of the Good Samaritan, it's a doctrine of love and the removal of prejudice.
Yeah.
The basic idea of the prodigal son is the Jews compared to the Gentiles. And a lot of people don't know that until you look at the context. And so it's not to say we can't find other truths in them. It's just that when the scriptures are clear in another area, we can't interpret a parable in a manner contradictory to a very clear passage of scripture. Something.
Is there a rule of thumb that you have at CARM or as a man, as a believer, for all the things that that we really are divided on in terms of all this stuff? Do you have a rule of thumb that says this is the rule that overrides everything? If you could explain what that is really quick, one word.
Well, Jesus.
Okay.
Just serve Jesus above your denominational doctrines. Let's be united in the faith instead of arguing with each other all the time to the point of anger and disfellowshipping, because we need to fight the real enemy out there. I'm not your enemy. You know, the Armenians aren't my enemy. The Lutherans aren't my enemy. Islam is. Mormonism, Jehovah's Witnesses, atheism. I hate the idea of Christian division. I don't mind teaching what a position is and going back and forth about it, but ultimately it has to do with Jesus Christ and him crucified.
Okay.
That is absolutely the bottom end for me.
Okay. And I just wanted to dispel, we'll wrap this up. Matt, thank you so much for coming next week. I just want to say that I have no enemy. I do not war against flesh and blood. Islam is not my enemy. Mormons are not my enemies. I do not have an enemy. I have war against principalities and powers in dark places, but no flesh and blood is my enemy as a believer. But this is something that we differ on too, and that's fine. We're going to love each other.
Thanks. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't consider them my enemies, but they're enemies of the gospel to some degree. We can use technical stuff, but it was fun.
Yeah. We'll do it next week. See you here on Heart of the Matter.
Okay, we'll see you.
Thanks, well, Matt.
Okay, bye.
I'm on the ride,
going nowhere. I am an existential cowboy on the wind, and I won't be coming out. I'm going in. This man's awake. A storm's arising, the dawn's waiting till 100 monkeys know. And I can feel